Pokémon Sword and Shield, for all its faults, is the most accessible game in the series for competitive battling. Never before has it been easier to build a battle-ready team to take online or to tournaments. However, this begs the question, are these new methods actually more efficient than the old ones? That's the question that we're going to answer today, so if that's what you're looking to find out, make sure to subscribe and stay tuned. For those of you who are unfamiliar with the inner workings of the game's mechanics, Pokémon stats are calculated using several values: base stats, IVs, nature, and EVs. Base stats are specific to each Pokémon in question. IVs are values between 0 and 31 that are determined when a Pokémon is created by the game. Natures provide a slight multiplier to two stats, raising one and lowering the other by 10%. With there also being 5 neutral natures that don't do anything. And lastly, EVs are values between 0 and 252 that are obtained every time you defeat a Pokémon in battle, which are for the most part out of the scope of this video, but they are something you do need to be aware of for competitive battling. For the single player adventure, you can largely ignore these, but when you switch to playing online and potentially competing in tournaments, you're going to have to make sure that your stats are as good as possible. Out of all of these attributes, by far, the most difficult part of obtaining a competitively viable Pokémon is getting a Pokémon with perfect IVs, as the chance of obtaining a Pokémon with perfect IVs in the wild is so low, you'll likely never see it happen. However, as of Generation 8, there are two methods you can use to make this process a bit easier: breeding and hypertraining. We'll start by talking about breeding, as that is the old way of doing it. This involves leaving two Pokémon at the daycare and hatching eggs until you get a perfect Pokémon. This uses the fact that the parents pass down some of their IVs at random to the hatched Pokémon, allowing you to significantly increase your odds of getting a Pokémon with the desired IVs. You can also use this to pass down natures and hidden abilities as well. If you're curious as to the specifics of how this system works and how to utilize it, I've linked to a few resources on everything you need to know in order to get started in the description. The big advantage of this system is due to the fact that IVs are passed down, it means that you are able to potentially use your perfect Pokémon in order to breed more. So once you get the ball rolling, you're able to go through the process faster the next time. They also don't need to be leveled up all the way, as many of the online modes automatically set all of your Pokémon to level 50. Lastly, you need breeding in order to get egg moves for certain Pokémon. Yes, Sword and Shield did change that so you can pass egg moves between Pokémon of the same species in the daycare, but that still doesn't eliminate the fact that you still need to get them onto a Pokémon of that species initially. The system is not without its disadvantages, though. Firstly, Pokémon hatch at level 1, which means that for some Pokémon like Dino and Larvitar who evolve late, you'll face a pretty uphill grind in order to get them sufficiently leveled, as opposed to just catching one in the wild area at level 60. Breeding is also very dependent on the RNG, and thus can be quite tedious as a result, as you're not guaranteed to get what you want after a certain number of eggs. It's all up to chance. You also have the problem of there being certain Pokémon, such as legendary and mythical Pokémon, which straight up can't be bred, thus making it impossible to do this process with them. Fortunately, since X and Y, they are guaranteed to have at least 3 perfect IVs, meaning it's less difficult to get one with good stats, but the odds are still pretty stacked against you. And lastly, if you remember, I said that IVs are passed down from parent to child with this method, which means that you need to get some Pokémon with good stats in the first place. Just like with legendary Pokémon, thankfully this has been made fairly easy in recent games, with things like Max Raid Battles guaranteeing Pokémon to have between 1 and 4 perfect IVs depending on the star rating of the rank. But that still makes it difficult for Pokémon that cannot be obtained from raids such as starters to have good IVs. Thankfully, that is not the only method. There is also hypertraining, the new way of doing things as of Generation 7. Basically, by using these things called bottle caps, you can max out the IVs in one stat on a level 100 Pokémon, with the rare gold bottle caps allowing you to max out all of them at once. This system is complemented by things such as the Nature Mints, which allow you to change the nature of a Pokémon, and the Ability Capsule, which allows you to switch between the two normal abilities on a Pokémon. The biggest strength of this system is that you don't need to know much about the ins and outs of the game's mechanics in order to utilize it, thus lowering the barrier of entry. You also have the advantage of being able to use it for Pokémon that cannot be bred in order to boost their stats. Also, it makes it far easier to have competitively viable shiny Pokémon. So if you're a shiny hunter who wants to play competitively, this may be the process for you. The disadvantages of this system are fairly obvious. First, because the Pokémon needs to be level 100, that means you'll have to grind them up, which, given that the highest level Pokemon you can find in the wild are level 60, could take a while. Of course, you could always just do raids to get rare and EXP candies, but it's still technically grinding either way. Second is that the items required are kind of a pain to get, each costing 50 BP in the Battle Tower, and not being super common elsewhere. So either prepare to do a lot of battles, or transfer a lot of Pokemon into Pokemon Home. Lastly is that it doesn't actually change the IVs or natures of a Pokemon. Yes, it does change your stats, but it doesn't allow those stats or natures to be bred, making it so that a hyper-trained Pokemon cannot be used to breed any more perfect IV Pokemon, meaning that you'll have to start the entire process from scratch when going about building a new team. So now that we've laid out the general advantages and disadvantages of each system, which is better? Frankly, breeding still seems to reign supreme, just by virtue of the fact that once you have competitively viable Pokemon, making more just becomes that much easier. I personally prefer hypertraining because doing raids is less tedious to me than biking back and forth on Route 5, but to each his own. However, I don't want to stop there. I don't want you to believe that you have to pick one or the other. There is actually a way to combine both of these methods to get the best of both worlds.
To paraphrase Hegel, advancement cannot occur without both thesis and antithesis.
This method starts with breeding a Pokemon that has the correct nature and ability and close to the IVs you want. The nature and ability part are optional, but the more you get done in this phase, the easier and less costly the second phase is going to be. Once you have that near-perfect Pokemon, deposit all of the other Pokemon you hatched into Pokemon Home, which then allows you to transfer BP back into your game. This hopefully should give you enough to buy everything that you'll need. This is partly why I said that the more you can get done by breeding, the better off you'll be, as the more you can get done in that phase, the more BP you'll potentially get out of Pokemon Home. By doing this, you'll be able to use that BP to buy the bottle caps and mints needed to hypertrain those last few stats. And there you go, that's the strengths of both systems of training Pokemon, and potentially a way to combine the two. Be sure to let me know what you guys think. Also, leave a like on this video and subscribe for more in the future. But until next time, guys, peace!